Empty Frames is an independent production. The commentary expressed here is our own and does not reflect the opinions of the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum or its staff. To learn more about the museum, including the 1990 theft, please visit the museum's website at www.isgm.org. If you have any critical information relating specifically to the 1990 theft, please contact the museum's security director via the options provided on the museum's website. The museum continues to offer a reward totaling $10 million for information that can lead to the return of the stolen artwork.
We are bothered by the loss the art world suffered in 1990, and we are not content with the status quo.
One stolen painting to note is from Manet, a French artist who created Che Tortoni, circa 1880. It's an elegant depiction of a man sketching a half-consumed beer on the table as he calmly looks at his audience. We started this podcast to raise awareness of the theft and to show our support for the ongoing recovery efforts. While those recovery efforts progress, as they do daily, we encourage our listeners to visit the museum, to appreciate its incredible collection, both past and present, and to donate directly to the museum through its website.
Again, if you enjoy this podcast and you feel as we do about the missing artwork, the most productive way for you to express your view is to donate directly to the Gardner Museum via its website. Go to isgm.org and look for the Join and Give tab, where there are options to make a donation of any size to support the museum's mission. Please donate today.
And when you do, let us know on Twitter so we can personally thank you there. Thanks again.
On March 18, 1990, the most audacious art heist of all time took place at the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum in Boston. Two men dressed as police officers were admitted into the building by security, claiming to be responding to a disturbance call.
In 81 minutes, 13 pieces of art were stolen. Among the portraits stripped from their frames were works by Vermeer, Degas, and Rembrandt. Estimated at $500 million, the heist has been categorized as the largest and most frustrating of all time. Theories of their whereabouts and those who perpetrated the crime are abundant.
In this podcast series, we will dig as deep as possible into the case, the theories, and the social and economic impact the greatest unsolved art heist of all time had on the community. This is Empty Frames, a heist story. Welcome back to Empty Frames. I'm Tim, here today with Lance in the Crawlspace Studios. What's up, Lance?
What is going on, Tim? How are you today?
I'm doing great. It's beautiful outside here in Boston, and we got a bunch of tweets for this book giveaway.
Yeah, we were given by Deb at HarperCollins The Gardner Heist by Ulrich Boser, and The Art of the Heist, Confessions of a Master Thief, by Miles Connor and Jenny Seiler, generously given to us, and we're going to give them away to a couple of people who tweeted the most interesting tweets to us, and we are the judges on here, so basically it's up to us to come up with the most interesting ones.
We're the final word. And today's episode, we are talking to former Gardner night watchman Geoffrey Rockwell. He is currently an artist living in Brooklyn, and he was a night watchman and worked there, and so we have a fascinating interview.
What I like about the direction the show is going is we're not talking about the ordinary business of the heist. We get into a little bit of, you know, in the previous episodes, we get a little bit on the mob angle and this angle and that angle, but I like the direction of exploring the museum through the eyes of a former night watchman. He was there just before the heist, so he wasn't present when it happened, but it still affected him. He still had experience with law enforcement after the heist, and really cool guy, and gives us a really unique insight into what it's like wandering the halls of the Gardner Museum after hours.
Okay, so the first tweet we got in this book giveaway, Lance, We got one from Dave Powers. He says, my theory is that the subjects were like the moving paintings from the Harry Potter universe, and they grew tired of their confinements and decided to extricate themselves.
I said right in the beginning when we started this book giveaway, didn't I, Tim? I said, if we get something that can connect Harry Potter with the heist, that's our tweet. I didn't say that.
But we love it anyway. What a great tweet. And we got one from Tony Dixon. He says, I can't help but to picture the heist going down like the scene in the 1989 Batman movie where their Joker and his minions take over the museum. He says, if you want to solve this case, call Batman.
That also creates a great visual, too, because you remember that scene from Batman where Prince's song Party Man is playing while Jack Nicholson is spray painting smiley faces on the paintings. And to put that in the Gardner, you know, world is a really, really cool visual. It's a really cool imagery to have.
I agree. So a couple of great tweets there. So thank you, Tony and Dave. And whoever tweets us first on a private message gets to choose the book. And then the books, of course, are The Gardner Heist by Ulrich Boser and The Art of the Heist, Confessions of a Master Thief by Miles Connor and Jenny Seiler.
I'm going to put a bonus out there as well. I'm going to say Tim and I will write an accompanying note with the book. A little personal message from us that you can frame using framebridge.com and put it up in your living room.
And the honorable mention tweet goes out to Real Savage. They say, at @empty_frames, I'm done with this podcast. You're both tired of our electoral college? That figures. This is a platform. You're at work. Why do you think I need to know your political leanings? End tweet. Well, Real Savage, pretty sure we just joke in one of our ad reads.
When I read that tweet, my first reaction was, wow, that was just a joke. It was a off-the-cuff joke. I actually, full transparency here, I stole it from David Mamet's movie State and Maine. That is not an original joke, and I thought that it fit in there with the problem that Tim had presented to me. But we have a follow-up on that, right?
Well, the funny thing is that Trump came out this week and also said that he's tired of the Electoral College. So you really can't win with politics either way you go. And trust me, we didn't give our political leanings.
Right. That is where that's not a platform that I am choosing to stand on. It was just a joke.
Other honorable mentions, one from Evie, who says she started an account just for us. So thanks, Evie. Welcome to Twitter. Your theory is based off of episode 5. Isabella Stewart Gardner made a lot of waves in Boston and had close relationships with married men. Is it possible that an heir of a spurned wife was getting back? It's far-fetched, but is it disproved?
Yikes. So we're talking a little revenge here. It's a good theory. I like where your head's at. Keep those ideas coming, of course.
And then Lindsay says, low-level mafia member was holding on to them, panicked because of how huge it got, and threw them away or shoved them in an attic. Low-level mobster dies in an unrelated incident. Now others don't know where they are. Still in dusty attic?
Lindsay, is this a confession?
Speaking of confessions, Kat Harding accused us. She says her theory is that we pulled off the heist and now we're doing the podcast to better hide in plain sight.
We love that.
I was 9 years old back then. I think Lance was 35.
I was 35 and just noticing that I was balding.
Okay, so here we are. Let's play this interview with artist Geoffrey Rockwell. Thank you very much for listening. Follow us on Twitter @empty_frames. We're also on Instagram and Facebook.
We're literally everywhere. Check out emptyframespodcast.com as well.
If you've listened to our show before, you've heard us talk about FrameBridge. It's amazing, isn't it, Lance?
FrameBridge is really, really cool when it comes time to framing your prints, your posters, photos. You can take them on your phone and you can send them right to FrameBridge.
Yeah, they make it super easy and affordable. But did you know that a custom framed photo from FrameBridge makes the perfect Mother's Day gift?
Wasn't even considering that, but now that you said it, that's amazing.
It's ridiculously easy. You just order in a few minutes and FrameBridge will send along a one-of-a-kind framed picture that your mom will love.
That perfect gift for mom is probably already on your phone. Just upload your photo and order by Sunday, May 6th for guaranteed free delivery in time for Mother's Day.
Hurry, hurry, hurry. Just go to framebridge.com. Pick a great photo. The expert team at Framebridge will frame it and send it straight to you, or they can deliver straight to your mom in time for Mother's Day when you place your order by Sunday, May 6th.
And while you need to get this going now, don't panic. You can preview your item online in any frame style. Choose your favorite. Or get free recommendations from their talented designers.
That's what we did, Lance. The amazing team at Framebridge expertly helped us frame our items. And you know what we got? We got, for the Crawlspace Studios, Lance?
We got a fantastic framed portrait. And not just a picture. This is a portrait of the Empty Frames logo. It dominates the room.
I would say it ties the room together.
In a dominating way.
The best part, though, instead of the hundreds you'd pay at a framing store, Framebridge prices start at $39 and all shipping is free.
That's incredible. Plus, there has to be more. Our listeners get 15% off their first order at framebridge.com when they use our promo code FRAMES.
Framebridge has thousands of five-star reviews and even offers a happiness guarantee. If for any reason you aren't 100% satisfied with your order, they'll make it right.
And you want to make it right for mom on Mother's Day. Order a custom gift for any mom in your life right from your phone.
Just go to framebridge.com and use promo code FRAMES. You'll save an additional 15% off your first order.
Just go to framebridge.com, promo code FRAMES, F-R-A-M-E-S. It's really easy because it's in their name too.
Framebridge.com, promo code FRAMES. Welcome to Empty Frames, Geoffrey Rockwell. How are you, Geoffrey?
I'm good.
Great. Thanks for joining us. So you are a former guard.
A former night watchman.
Okay. Thank you.
No problem.
Yes, I worked at the Gardner Museum in the late 80s as a night watchman.
Very cool. You came to us in a sort of roundabout way. Our Mr. K had forwarded an article that you had written after your time at the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum. He forwarded us this article, and we read it and instantly thought, we need to have this guy on the show, because it just became very apparent that you had knowledge of the museum itself. Can you talk a little bit about that article that I mentioned?
A friend of mine who works at the Globe asked me to write that because they were doing a special insert and for the Globe, I think it was about 6 years ago. They had done some renovations at the museum and expanded it a bit, and they were doing a special issue in the insert in the Globe for that. So she asked me to write this piece.
And the name of the article is Confessions of a Former Night Watchman?
Yeah, former Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum Night Watchman, yeah.
Okay, yeah, we'll
bit of a tongue twister there.
Yeah, we'll link to it for the listeners, because it is a really, really good article.
Can I ask one question before actually getting to any of the nitty-gritty about the heist or the job? What were the paintings like? So you were there before they got stolen.
Oh, sure. The Vermeer painting was one of my favorite paintings in the entire museum. So when I heard that that had been stolen, that was particularly painful. My other favorites of the ones that were stolen was the Storm on the Sea of Galilee, the Rembrandt painting. That was a really striking painting, and apparently was the only seascape that Rembrandt had ever painted. And one interesting thing, there's a little self-portrait of him that he painted as one of the crew members on the ship.
That's right. Yeah, he's looking right at the artist, I suppose, right?
Or right himself. At the viewer. Yeah, he's looking at you.
Those two pieces were a real loss. All of the work that was stolen, you know, it's just tragic. Yeah.
And you're an artist as well. You currently reside in New York, and you work as an artist. And you sent us, in preparation for this interview, you sent us two of your sketches, one
right.
of the concert and one of the Storm on the Sea of Galilee. And that was those are really cool. Was that something that you would do while you worked there?
Before I started as a night watchman, I worked as a gallery attendant for a couple of months, And although they had a prohibition on this, I always carried a sketchbook with me, and when there weren't too many people in the galleries, I would sketch the artworks, and I had done a couple of both those paintings I talked about, the concert and Storm on the Sea of Galilee. So I thought you guys might be interested in seeing that.
So you said that they had a prohibition on carrying notebooks. Is that for the sole purpose to not have people sketch the artwork, or was it just that they didn't want any record keeping?
I think if you were a visitor, you could get permission to do this. But, you know, I would say 75% of the security guards were art students or young artists, and they just probably didn't want to have too much sketching going on by the staff. It, you know, be too distracting.
Oh, right.
Protecting the artwork, not studying it so much, you know?
Right.
Exactly.
What was the difference between those jobs that you held at the Gardner?
Well, you know, one was during the day when the museum was open, and the other one was at night when it was closed. Being a night watchman was much more interesting to me. So I was really happy when someone quit and there was a position open, and I immediately asked Lyle Grindle, who was the head of security at the time, if I could have that job, and he agreed. So
why was it a more sought-after position?
Well, for most people it probably wasn't, because the hours are weird, and it's I think a lot of people would find it boring, but I really liked it because the experience of wandering around in the galleries at night and looking at the artwork and checking out the vibe of the whole place was it's really kind of exciting.
That leads me to one of my questions. You walked around the galleries at night. I guess it's a two-part question. What was the protocol for a night watchman, and what could you sort of get away with as far as doing your own exploration, curiosity satisfying?
There were two people working, and we would alternate. One person would sit at the security desk, and the other person would do a round of all of the museum grounds. And then you're supposed to alternate. So one person would do a round, and then that person would then sit at the desk, and the other person would do a round. And so you go everywhere in the museum, all kinds of places that most people never got a chance to see. Like there was an attic part of the museum that was filled with a lot of objects and sculptures and things like that never got exhibited, because one of Isabella Stewart Gardner's policies was that nothing could be changed. You know, she set up everything exactly in a very specific way. So there was a lot of stuff that she owned that has never got exhibited. So as a night watchman, you got a chance to look at all this stuff, you know, like Roman heads and things like that. There are also parts of the museum that are roped off. So as a normal guest, you wouldn't be able to get into these places, but as a guard, you would have to, because the way it was done at that time, and I think it was changed shortly after I stopped working there, was that in each room, there was a key, and you would carry around kind of a large clock about the size of a canteen. And you would go into each room and you'd take the key and you'd put it into the clock that you carried to turn it. And that would record what time you were in each room. In some of these rooms, this key was in a part of the gallery that was roped off. So you'd, you know, climb back there and there'd be all this stuff that nobody ever got a chance to see, and you could check it out.
Was that something that was commonly known to visitors?
Well, it was a surprise to me. When I first became a night guard, I had no idea that this existed, man.
What was the security like inside the attic? Was it something that, had a motion detector? Was it the same as through the galleries? Like, if someone was up there, you'd know it?
Yeah, there was motion detectors in all the rooms.
The director of the museum at the time essentially lived in a
a penthouse apartment at the museum during the period that you worked there, correct?
Yes, yeah.
And what was his name?
Roland Hadley.
Okay, was it typical for directors to live in this apartment?
I assume so at the time. I don't know what the history was with the directors before or after him. But he lived there. He was kind of an odd guy. He was a real Boston blue blood, you know, if you could picture like a combination of William Buckley and Thurston Howell. He might end up with a Roland Hadley. And
would a solid definition of that be described as Brahmin, or am I confused?
Yeah, right.
Okay, like a hot potato Boston in the mouth Brahmin. Type.
That's it. And, you know, he had kind of this royal air, and he acted as if it was his house in a way. Yeah.
Okay.
So essentially, you'd be at night when you're doing your rounds and you're going through the galleries, he might consider that as you kind of roaming through his house.
Sure. Yeah.
That's great.
Was he polite enough?
Oh, yeah. You know, okay. I don't want to dish too much on him. He was dismissive of the staff, you know. Position. Yeah.
So what about hiding in the museum? Was there any chance that anyone could have hid inside the museum after it closed?
No, I don't think that would have been possible because there are motion detectors in all of the galleries. And we would have seen this at the desk. At the desk, there was a large board with lights, you know, and the next to each light was the name of the gallery. And so if there was anything moving in any of the galleries, the light would show up that, you know, that the motion detector was being set off. And I know that this would happen because often I worked the second shift, which was probably like 3 to 11. So I was there while the museum was still open. And then after it closed, and, you know, sometimes after the museum closed, some curators or whoever might be lingering around in certain rooms, and you could see where they were by the board that we had with the motion detector lights.
And this is the local alarm system, correct?
This is local alarm. It wasn't connected to the police, although at the desk we did have a button like a bank teller might have that you could press and that would immediately call the police.
Okay, cool. We can get into this now. You said earlier that the night shift always has two people, or always had two people. One would be at the desk, and one would be going through the galleries, making the rounds. When you're sitting at the desk, you said under the desk, like a bank teller, like you'd imagine, would have an emergency alarm directly connected to the police department.
Mm-hmm.
And also at the desk, there was a monitor that was connected to the camera, which was outside the security door on Palace Road, correct?
Right, yeah.
So walk us through the process of if I'm a night watchman sitting at that desk and I am approached by somebody who is, you know, asking to enter that side entrance.
Well, okay, they would ring the buzzer and you could see them on the video screen. And if it was somebody that you knew, you know, maybe you'd buzz them in. And they would first come in through, there were two doors that they would have to come in through. First, they would come in through the first door, and then they'd be inside a small foyer where if you're sitting at the security desk, there's a big window, and you could see the person who was inside this small foyer. Then you would have to buzz them in again to go through the second door to actually enter the area where the security desk was.
That's great. The first view that you see of anybody who wants to enter through that security entrance is on the monitor, and that's
right,
facing outside. And mm-hmm. How clear is the monitor if you were to look at that? Would you be able to tell if it's a pizza delivery guy or if it's a...
Yes, you would know who is outside, yeah.
Okay, I think we know what I'm getting at.
It was pretty clear. It was live feed. I think it was a different camera than this security footage that came out not too long ago, that shows somebody being buzzed in the night before the robbery.
Different angle, really?
I think that's a different thing. I think that was one of these security cameras that takes a picture like every 5 seconds or something.
Oh.
And the what we had was a live feed, but it wasn't being recorded. And this was the late 80s, so they weren't so advanced technologically.
Gotcha. So that was just more for the purpose of the guard to see what was going on outside, wasn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, right.
For documenting.
Lance, do you sleep on a Casper mattress?
Is there any other mattress to sleep on?
No, I agree. I mean, there are other mattress brands out there, of course, but Casper products are cleverly designed to mimic human curves, providing support comfort for all kinds of bodies. So that's one reason why I love my Casper mattress.
Well, the other reason is that you spend one third of your life sleeping, so you should be comfortable during that one third of your life.
I never sleep. I'm like Chuck Norris like that.
You don't sleep, you wait.
And Casper offers a wide array of other products like pillows and sheets to ensure an overall better sleep experience. Casper offers two other mattresses besides the original, and these are called the Wave and the Essential. With over 20,000 reviews and an average of 4.8 stars across Casper, Amazon, and Google, Casper is becoming the internet's favorite mattress.
Tim, these mattresses, they're all developed, designed, and assembled right here in the US of A.
Perfect. And affordable prices because Casper cuts out the middleman and sells directly to you. Hassle-free returns if you're not completely satisfied.
These things are delivered right to your door in a small, how do they do that size box? The thing just blows up in front of you.
Oh, it's like the best part, actually. I mean, one of the best parts.
Gather the family around and fire up that mattress.
Free shipping and returns in the U.S. and Canada as well. You can be sure of your purchase with Casper's 100-night risk-free sleep-on-it trial.
So listeners get $50 towards select mattresses by visiting casper.com/frames and using promo code FRAMES at checkout. Terms and conditions apply.
Check out casper.com/frames.
Gather the family around, pop that mattress open, get some popcorn, and sleep well.
What about the security room then? As a night watchman, would you have known where any footage of you would have been? I guess the footage from the night before, that angle, would you have known where to find that from the night of the heist?
No. If someone were to ask me, okay, where are the tapes for the security cameras? I would say, okay, they're probably in the head of security's office, but I would have had no idea where to look for them. I was never shown where the tapes were or anything like that.
Is it your opinion that that is just protocol, or was that an oversight of the head of security? Meaning, was it protocol because they don't want their night watchman knowing, maybe for their own safety in case they do get robbed? Actually, that doesn't make sense. So what's your opinion on that? Was it they're not supposed to tell the night watchman where the security room is?
I don't know if it was planned that way, but I just didn't know where they were, and I don't imagine that other night guards did either. Maybe some of the guys that worked there, there were some guys that worked there for quite a long time. So maybe they knew these things, but I didn't.
Did you have any crossover with Richard Abbott?
No, he started after I left.
Right, you were there from 86 to 88, so yeah, you would have missed him. And you lived in Boston at the time, right?
Yeah, JP.
JP, nice. JP's a great neighborhood.
Do you know when those motion detectors got put in?
No.
Okay.
I'd imagine they'd been there for years before I started there.
Because some people had said that they had squatted in the museum, that they did stay in overnight and actually slept in there. And I'm not sure when that was. It wasn't probably in the 80s, might have been the 60s or 70s, potentially later. But you're saying if those motion detectors were in at that time, there's no way.
Yeah, no one could have done that when I was working there.
What about Larry O'Brien? Did he look like the man on the footage from the night before video?
Yeah, I didn't know Larry. I think he must have started either right at the very end of when I was working there, or maybe he even started after. The second in command for security under Lyle was a guy named Chuck when I was there. And I seem to remember that, you know, Chuck quit because he wanted to work for the railroads or something like that. And then they got a new guy, and that might have been Larry, but I don't know. And I know that some people say that the person on that security camera footage of the night before the robbery looks like him, but I wouldn't be able to say for sure because I don't remember him.
As far as the job goes, you had said that there was specifically one hard and fast rule that you don't let anybody in, correct?
Yeah, well, I mean, we had a lot of rules, but that was definitely one that was very clear, like don't let anyone into the building unless they work there. Yeah.
Did anybody give you any instructions on if you saw police officers asking to be buzzed in?
No, we were never given a plan for that.
And this is just an opinion question. If you had been in that situation and you saw what was quite possibly police officers, two of them outside without a police car around, and they wanted to come in, would you have hit the alarm that goes directly to the police department that was at the security desk just as a precaution?
Yeah, I mean, that's really hard to say. Of course, I would like to think that I would not have let them in, but that's really hard to say.
So you stopped working at the museum in 1987, and the heist, of course, happened in 1990. So you weren't interviewed by the Boston police or the FBI or anything, right?
No, I was interviewed by the FBI.
You were?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. I was living in New York at the time. I moved out of Boston in 88, I think. And they found me through my father. So I like to joke that my dad ratted me out to the feds. But Detective Dan Falzone called me, and then I talked to him for a while on the phone. And then two agents came down and interviewed me in person.
What was that like?
That was really interesting. I mean, it was kind of funny, too. Like, the first thing is, like, I was working for a mural painting company in Lower Manhattan. And they came to where I was working. And for some reason, it was surprising to me, but they look exactly like FBI agents that you see on TV, you know, with the trench coats and mirrored sunglasses and crew cuts and skinny black ties and whatnot. And of course, they do the whole thing where they flip open their FBI identification.
Okay.
And you know, so that was kind of funny. And then they wanted to interview me in their car, but I lived just a couple of blocks away from where I was working. So I thought, okay, why don't we just go to where I live? Because I lived in kind of a, you know, run-down loft space on Canal Street, which was, you know, this was a long time ago, so it was before it was gentrified. It was kind of, I thought that if I brought these guys to where I live, then they'll see that obviously, even if I was involved with the robbery at all, I didn't make any money off of it because I was living in the dump. So we got there and sat down, and they asked me questions for probably a little over an hour or so. And that was strange to me, too, because they asked questions exactly the way you would see it on TV. There was one of the guys was really friendly and nice and chatty, and the other guy just glared at me with his, you know, elbows on his knees and didn't say anything. They, you know, they asked, one guy asked me all kinds of questions, and every once in a while he would throw in a question that was sort of like a curveball, I don't know, to see how I would react.
They were all questions relating to the heist, and had you heard about the heist before you were contacted by
them?
Oh,
sure, yeah. I was actually in Italy when the robbery happened, so I have an alibi.
Likely story, Geoffrey.
And I heard about it, and I was shocked, and I had been keeping up a lot with whatever developments there were about it, so I knew quite a bit about it by the time that I spoke to the FBI. But most of their questions were about security at the museum and different people that work there, and you know, things like that. And then, you know, they asked me a couple of trick questions, like, did I ever think about how I might go about stealing something from there? And that was the only time that I don't want to get myself in trouble by saying that I lied to the FBI, because it seems like that's something that gets people in trouble these days. But I said that I had, because I had thought about stealing something, because that was part of my job. But actually, in fact, I don't think that I ever had considered stealing anything from there.
What did the bad cop in that good cop, bad cop situation think about
that?
He
didn't change his expression once. He just sat there like a...
He mad dogged you?
Yeah.
That's what Lance does to all our interview subjects. Yeah. I'm usually asking the probing questions, and he's just mad-dogging people.
You should see how I'm staring at the phone right now.
Man, that's a good technique.
Are you aware of the FBI interviewing any of your other coworkers or any anyone else, like any other night watchman from that time or guard from that time?
Well, I assume that if they tracked me down, they must have been asking... they must have been looking into everybody that worked there, but I haven't spoken to anyone. You know, I lost track of all the people that I knew there, and I never heard any other stories about anybody being interviewed. But I imagine most people were.
Could you glean anything from their line of questioning? Like obviously you're not guilty. Were they asking about specific people like more than once or anything like that?
I can't think of anything. I imagine that there wasn't anything that really stuck out to me at the time, or else I would have remembered it. I can't say that gave me any hints about what direction they were going with the investigation. It just seemed to me like they were asking a lot of questions about the security system and different people that worked at the museum, and you know, like gathering information and sort of evaluating how I was answering their questions.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
You seem to have a pretty decent memory about, you know, that time frame when you worked there, and your story has a pretty amusing anecdote about an incident that happened involving a candelabra, I believe. Do you mind elaborating a bit on that story?
Yeah, sure. One thing that I like to do when I was making rounds was looking at artwork with the flashlight. We carry this really large flashlight, about a foot and a half long, which was our only weapon, according to Lyle. And it was a, you know, pretty powerful flashlight. And if you looked at certain oil paintings with the flashlight, you could see through different layers of the glaze down to the underpainting. I really liked doing this, you know, because as a young painter, I could learn a lot about how some of these painters had made their paintings. The night of this story, I was up in the Gothic room, which is on the third floor, and in there was one of my favorite paintings. It was Adam and Eve by Lucas Cranach. So I was stepping back from the painting to get the whole thing within the beam of the flashlight, and I felt like something hard jab in between my shoulder blades, and I immediately knew what it was. And there was this medieval candelabra about 5 feet tall, made of cast iron. I could feel it after I hit it. I could feel that I knocked it off balance, and then I could feel, you know, because it was totally dark, I couldn't see it. I could feel like this kind of vacuum open up behind me, and then the candelabra had tipped over completely and hit the floor with a really loud sound, you know, really loud crash like a gong. And right after that, my walkie-talkie started squawking because the woman that I was working with that night was calling me because she heard the crash, and she was, you know, freaked out. It's like, what is that? What was that sound? And, you know, I didn't know what to say. So I said, oh, I think it's coming from the second floor. I'll go down and check it. So I, you know, I ran down to the second floor. And of course, nothing was going on down there. Then when I went back to the desk, I played dumb. And she was kind of a superstitious sort. In fact, when I worked with her, she was too nervous to do the rounds in the museum, so I would do all of her rounds and my rounds, and she would just sit at the desk the whole night. So I kind of let her think that maybe something supernatural happened. And and then on my next round, I checked out the candelabra and I put it back up, and one thing had been I'm not sure what you would call it. One of the things that held one of the candles was bent, and I was able to bend it back in place, but everything else was fine, except some of the tiles in the floor had been chipped. So the next night I brought some crazy glue, and I glued the tiles back together, and you can still see it today. I was at the museum a few years ago with some friends, and I was telling them the story, and as proof, I found where the cracked tiles were.
So anyone who's listening and you haven't found a reason to go to the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum, we just are going to lay one more reason on you, and that is to head up to the Gothic room and check out the candelabra and some repaired but still semi-cracked tiles from your days as a night watchman.
Lance, you know, there's a lot of problems in the world, but one problem is that 66% of men lose their hair by age 35.
And 35 is right around the corner for us, too. I'm a little nervous.
Well, thing is, when you start to notice hair loss, it's too late. It's easier to keep the hair you have than replace the hair you've lost.
Man, I ask myself every morning, is my hairline slowly starting to run away? Does it look like someone's standing on my eyebrows with a flamethrower telling my hairline to get back?
Did you just make that up? That's really clever.
I'm riffing.
But the solution to this problem, Lance, is 4hims.com. It's a one-stop shop for hair loss, skin care, and sexual wellness for men.
Now, Hims connects you with real doctors and medical-grade solutions. It's going to treat your hair loss.
Thanks to science, baldness can be optional. Well-known generic equivalents to name-brand prescriptions to help you keep your hair.
Now, we're not talking snake oil pills or gas station counter supplements. They're prescription solutions, like you said, backed by science.
No waiting room, no awkward doctor visits. You save hours by going to 4hims.com. It's so easy.
So easy, and I hate awkward doctor visits. I just want to answer a few quick questions, and then a doctor will review and then prescribe to you.
Yep, and products are shipped directly to your door.
The only person that knows is your mailman.
So order now. Our listeners get a trial month of Hims for just $5 today, right now, while supplies last. See websites for full details. This would cost hundreds if you went to the doctor or a pharmacy.
So go to 4hims.com/frames. That's 4hims, forhims.com/frames.
4hims.com/frames.
Now, that brought up another question as you were telling that story. Was it very common to communicate with your fellow night watchman by way of walkie-talkie? Did that kind of communication happen a lot?
Yeah.
So if you were sitting at the desk and you saw someone needed to be buzzed in, would it be instinctual for you to radio to the other person or just take matters into your own hands and allow or disallow someone to enter?
That's a good question. I had never thought of that before. Yeah, no, that's a really tough question, because there was quite a lot of, as I remember, a lot of communication between the person who's doing the rounds and the person who's sitting at the desk, because, you know, it's kind of lonely work, you know, so...
Yeah, I agree. I almost picture myself doing it and just, you know, doing the rounds early 20s and maybe even just joking around just to, because I can imagine walking through a dark museum and maybe getting a little paranoid or, you know, a little freaked out and just needing that communication with another human just to kind of break it up a little bit. So that's where my head went to, in addition to obviously the night of the heist. Would it be instinctual for somebody to say, you know, hey, might want to come down here?
Hey, police are here. Can you come down?
Exactly. You
know? But, you know, who's to say, like, would you radio the other guard after the police had come in or while they were waiting outside? You know what I mean? Like, if you actually believed that they were police, would you leave them outside while you radioed the other guard and said that the police are here, you should come down? Or, you know what I mean? Like, I don't know.
Yeah, I get what you're saying.
I'm not sure. I don't know how I would have reacted in that situation. So
I don't know how I would react either, because when you see policemen anyway, that seems to trump any priority. So
right. You
want to attend to the policemen. I have one quick question about the view that the guard sees when he's at the security desk from the camera that's outside, which you said is not the same camera that is in the video from the night before. This is a live feed going outside, very clear. Is it the entire street? Like, would you be able to see if a car pulled up and people exited the car?
No, I don't think so. It was more like a video for buzzing someone into an apartment building or something. You know what I mean? I think it was probably mounted just above the door. So you would just see the person. I don't know if you would see much of what was going on behind them.
I see. So it was almost like a straight on kind of medium shot of anyone standing there. It wasn't like a full body shot with a street in the
right.
back. Okay, cool. Was there any image that a guard could look at that would show the street from the security desk?
Yeah, I don't remember. Yeah. I think maybe you could see the you know, the security camera footage that was being shot that would switch back and forth between the street and outside the door. I think we were able to watch that as well, but I'm not 100% sure on that.
I see. Well, you know, I'm just being retrospective and, you know, hindsight's 20/20, and I like to imagine sitting there and looking and seeing the first image of the police officers from that door camera, and then double checking to see if they had a car there, if the lights were on. But who knows, you know, if I'm 20 years old and it's my night job and I see police officers, that might just go right to the top of my priority list and I'm going to buzz them in.
The questionable thing about that is why did the police show up? You know, if they were real police officers and nobody in the museum had called them, because What was the thing that these guys said to get into the museum?
They're here about the disturbance in the courtyard.
They heard about a disturbance in the courtyard. How would they have heard about that without having been notified by a guard in the museum? There was no...
Right.
The only way they would have heard about a disturbance in the courtyard would have been if a security guard had called them, or if they had pushed this alarm button. So, I mean, that's a suspicious. I would hope that, you know, as a good security guard, I would have thought, like, what do you mean disturbance in the courtyard? We didn't report anything. What I remembered was that they had found that the motion detectors for the blue room, where the Manet Chez Tortini
yep.
was stolen, that those motion detectors hadn't been set off after the burglars entered the museum, but there was some weird stuff that had happen with the motion detectors in that room before.
Yeah, the motion detectors detected movement in the blue room at 12:27 a.m. and at 12:53 a.m., which was about a half hour before the two costumed police officers buzzed.
Right.
And so, yeah, and so the thieves never made their way, or at least those two thieves never made their way to the blue room. So whoever that was most likely took the Che Tortoni off the wall.
Right.
So, yeah, regardless of the intentions of this confusion around if you're a night watchman and police arrive and tell you that they're there because of a disturbance in the courtyard, and you're thinking as a night watchman, well, there's no disturbance in the courtyard because I would know. That's right. That's confusing. But Tim's point is also, if there was a disturbance anywhere, where did that come from? And what's the, is that just a coincidence? Like the night before video was a coincidence that someone showed up, you know?
Yeah. Where the security guard desk was, if there was a disturbance in the courtyard, you would know it. And because you weren't that far away from the courtyard, 10 yards or so.
Oh,
right.
Okay.
Abbeth opened the door, right? Like a little bit before they came in as well. So maybe
opened and closed the door.
Yeah.
You're talking about when he says that he tested
what,
it.
The side entrance door?
Yeah. I believe the same entrance they came in, I believe.
So, yeah, Abbeth has said before that he opened and closed the Palace Road door, which I'm assuming that is the same side entrance door that we're talking about. And he said that he's done that several other times to make sure that it's locked. And he also claimed that the security logs, which is another question, he claimed that the security logs would indicate that he's telling the truth, that I do always open and close that door to make sure that it's locked. Did you fill out security logs? Is this like a handwritten logbook, or is it a more of a time-stamped, you know, computerized thing?
No, we didn't have a logbook, a handwritten one that I remember.
Oh, that's interesting. Because I guess the FBI has possession of those security logs that Abbeth claimed has his, you know, account of opening and closing the door. That's interesting. Maybe.
Now that you're talking about it, I seem to actually to remember you would write down if who came in and at what time.
Gotcha. So it probably wasn't something that was so official that it was, they probably weren't scanning IDs and giving people, you know.
No, it was, you know, it was pretty passes. Low tech.
So I just have two more quick questions. One, you experienced what it was like down in the basement in the boiler room area, and that was where Abbeth was taken by the thieves while they did their thieving. What was that? What was that area like?
Well, it was a long hallway with the boilers and, you know, heating stuff. It was sort of like the bowels of the museum, basically. You know, I think maybe they had the circuit breakers and whatnot.
And my last question is, who in Italy did you sell the stolen Minate?
Just kidding.
That was my bad cop.
Yeah.
Thank you for listening to Empty Frames, a co-production of Crawlspace Media and Audioboom. Original music by Jared Jensen. Please learn more by going to emptyframespodcast.com and crawlspacepodcast.com.
Thank you very much for listening. Follow Empty Frames on Twitter at @empty_frames. We're also on Facebook and Instagram as Empty Frames Podcast. We'll be back in 2 weeks, and we talk to former Gardner guard Marge Gallis, who has this to say.
There was a man that at one point was very disrespectful, disobedient, so I had to call one of the supervisors on duty that day. He went into the office, closed the door. He was in there for a while doing who knows what. That's where all of the recording devices for the tapes were kept. That's where the thieves had broken into that door and stole those recording devices.